Released in 1986, Blue Velvet is considered to be one of auteur David Lynch's most prolific works. The film is a twisted, seductive mystery that follows a string of dark clues which lead to several terrifying discoveries. In this analysis video, I will be taking a look at the film's themes, characters, and more to show you how by mixing a neo-noir mystery with his signature dreamlike imagery and motifs, David Lynch uncovers small-town America's darkest secrets in a polarizing thriller made way ahead of its time. Jeffrey Beaumont, home from college after his father suffers from a stroke, discovers a severed ear in a field while out walking. He takes the evidence to the police, who collect it and dismiss him. With an unforeseen tip from the detective's daughter, Jeffrey continues his investigation on the ear, but soon finds himself enveloped in a world of darkness and horror after he is crossed with an attractive woman, a dangerous man, and their associates. Duality is a major theme in Blue Velvet. The film opens with a montage of picturesque American suburbia. Blue skies, white picket fences, children safely crossing the street. But the camera soon moves under the ground to reveal the unsettling truth of vile insects writhing around in the dirt. These insects serve as a polar opposite to the suburban perfection above and represent the dark evil that lurks just beneath the surface of this perfect little town. Duality is also seen when comparing and contrasting the characters of the film. Young and innocent Jeffrey Beaumont is clearly a stark contrast to Frank Booth's evil and reprehensible character. The same can be said about the difference between naive little Sandy Williams and the mature, seductive Dorothy Valens. You can even see disparity in the set design. Just compare the frequented rendezvous spot of our heroes, the quaint and cozy diner, to the dark and seedy Slow Club, a bar where Frank and his gang of misfits gather to hear Dorothy sing. Duality is everywhere in this film, implying it's a natural, necessary part of life. Ignorance is another primary theme in the film. Through Jeffrey's many discoveries of new information, he gains self-knowledge and sheds his ignorance. Once he's made himself aware of the truth, Jeffrey is shown to be severely troubled by the evil surrounding him, not only because everyone seems to ignore it, or that he doesn't want it to exist, but because as Jeffrey faces enlightenment, he starts to become aware of the inherent evil within himself, the necessary duality of life, his innocence being completely erased in the process. The film also heavily reflects the dangers of willful ignorance. Every innocent person who inhabits this town seems to live absent-mindedly and with complete disregard to the evil that surrounds them. At some point, their brains adapted and circumvented the issue, leaving the darkness to take over anyone and everyone. Although the film heavily implies that it is dangerous, it should be noted that ignorance is actually what fuels Jeffrey's whole journey. Because he doesn't know about this town's hidden underbelly, Jeffrey wants to discover more and consequently shed himself of his innate ignorance. Dreams are ultimately the entire essence of the film. The primary example being the scene where Jeffrey and Sandy sit parked outside of a church and she delivers a monologue about a dream she had, wherein all the darkness in the world suddenly vanishes when the robins come. It's an uplifting scene that conjures up a lot of positive influence for Jeffrey on his mission, while totally contrasting all the grittiness of the film. The scene at Ben's house is quite possibly the most dreamlike portion of the entire film. Nothing about it hardly even makes sense. It's essentially using dream logic and uncanny performances to give us a real moving picture from our subconscious, or Lynch's subconscious. The meaning is for us to decide. On top of that, the song played in the sequence is entitled In Dreams, and Frank repeats the haunting lyrics back to Jeffrey later in the film. Dreams clearly hold a certain kind of power and influence in this film. Jeffrey Beaumont is a representation of righteousness. He begins as a well-intentioned, naive young man who doesn't have much purpose upon his return home from college, and is virtually ignored by those around him. While on a walk in search of meaning, Jeffrey willfully exposes himself to the dark world around him when he investigates the severed ear. On his journey, Jeffrey learns about the darkness within himself and comes out without his innocence, but also with a better understanding of himself and the world around him. Dorothy Valens is clearly a representation of beauty, but truly she is a representation of trauma. Initially a hostile and guarded person, she is later discovered to be a completely broken and damaged woman. This is because Frank has her son and husband kidnapped, and forces her to partake in his heinous sexual rituals to keep them alive. Dorothy seeks asylum in Jeffrey's caring arms after she catches him sneaking into her apartment to investigate. Frank Booth is a representation of pure, uncontrolled evil. An emotionally unstable drug lord mob boss who has irrationally violent and sexual fixations, Frank is a deadly force. But underneath his calloused exterior, like nearly every other aspect of this film, exists a polar opposite side. Frank's Freudian alter ego, a young child who is sexually fixated on his mother. He forces Dorothy to play the part as he inhales helium through an oxygen mask. Sandy Williams is a representation of purity, a sweet, naive high school girl who also happens to be the daughter of a detective. She initially aids Jeffrey in his mission with the advantage of her position, but soon backs out as things become more and more dangerous. Detective Williams is a representation of honesty, a firm but fair detective who wants to stop crime at any rate, but doesn't want others putting themselves at risk for it, especially not his family and friends. Ben is a representation of dreams. A fantasy-like character, Ben serves as the supplier of at least some of Frank's drugs. He is also requested by Frank to lip-sync one of his favorite songs, Roy Orbison's In Dreams. The film follows a typical narrative structure with the first act following Jeffrey Beaumont, his need for a purpose, and his want for mystery. His world turns upside down after he finds an ear lying in a field, which thrusts us to the second act. He is now compelled to follow this clue and learn more, but not without running into many obstacles along the way, such as the police's dismissal of him, a mysterious nightclub singer and the contents of her apartment, and an evil man who has control over her. Jeffrey becomes intent on saving Dorothy from her tragic situation and captures photographic evidence for the police, making his position more dangerous than ever. The false victory comes after the cops set up a sting at Frank's place and he is believed to be dead, but the false defeat reveals that Frank is alive and heading to Dorothy's apartment, where Jeffrey is putting the final pieces of the puzzle together. This thrusts us to the third and final act. Jeffrey shoots Frank in the head and kills him. Dorothy's husband is dead, revealed to be the owner of the ear, but she is reunited with her son. Jeffrey and Sandy make up after all the darkness subsides and the Robins come. As mentioned earlier, Lynch has a real fascination with dreams, citing The Wizard of Oz as one of his favorite films. Perhaps Dorothy Valens was named after the character from Kansas, but either way, both films share a dreamlike quality that is undeniably present. Blue Velvet was a shot in the arm for the career of legendary actor Dennis Hopper. His performance as Frank Booth is recognized by the AFI as one of the top 50 film villains of all time. This was also Lynch's second collaboration with cinematographer Frederick Elms after Eraserhead in 1977. The two work together very well and bring Lynch's ideas to life with vivid color and striking imagery. The film was certainly divisive upon its release. The initial reactions to test screenings were rough at best, with one person writing on their card, "David Lynch should be shot." The film was a commercial success and critics praised its boldly alien perspective, while others called it the sickest film ever made. Although the reactions were certainly mixed, the film went on to be nominated for an Academy Award for Best Director in 1987. Today, it is regarded by most as a cult classic and one of Lynch's best works. Blue Velvet is one of the strangest, most provocative, psychosexual thrillers of all time. It is a well-made film that really stays in your head. It is certainly not a film for everyone. It's guaranteed to make almost anyone uncomfortable, but that is all the more reason to watch it. To face the darkness we all know that lurks beneath the surface. Whatever that may be.